of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021. The second agenda item this morning is a decision to take item 4 on the consideration of evidence heard in private. Are members of the committee agreed? Thank you. We are agreed to take agenda item 4 in private. We shall now move on to take evidence on the vaccination program and pandemic preparedness. I welcome Hamza Yusuf, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care. The Cabinet Secretary is supported remotely by his officials, Derek Grieve, Head of Operational Vaccines Division, Professor Nicola Steedman, Deputy Chief Medical Officer, Karen Duffy, Deputy Director, COVID Vaccination Delivery, and Jonathan Cameron, Interim Director of the Digital Health and Care Directorate from the Scottish Government. Thank you for your attendance this morning. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make any remarks before we move to questions?
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to you all. It's a pleasure to be in front of committee. Just a few opening brief remarks, if I may, just to emphasise that Scotland's COVID-19 vaccination programme, along with the other four nations of the UK, has been one of the fastest in the world, a roaring success. It remains, of course, our best route out of this pandemic. As the programme now pivots to deliver booster vaccinations ahead of winter, I'm pleased to report that of people aged 18 and over, 92% have had a first dose of the vaccine and 86% have had a second dose. Additionally, a further 72% of 16 and 17-year-olds and 28% of 12 to 15-year-olds have been given a single dose of the vaccine. Now, these remarkable achievements have really only been possible through the colossal effort, Herculean effort, that's been made by our National Health Service, our delivery partners, the volunteers, the Army, many who have been involved in what is, as I say, a roaring success. I thank them for their immense contribution to the success of the programme in meeting and surpassing its targets. But thanks must also be given to people, the general public, for coming forward, for understanding the information, taking their time to read the information about the vaccine, and making themselves available to get vaccinated. One of the most demanding aspects of the programme has undoubtedly been the challenge of reacting and adapting to advice from clinical experts. And let me also thank those clinical experts, because perhaps they don't often get enough recognition for the difficult decisions that they have to make. I particularly wish to commend the resilience and responsiveness demonstrated in moving rapidly to implement new clinical advice as it's emerged throughout the programme. For example, extending our offer to 12 to 15-year-olds, following advice from both the JCVI and four UK chief medical officers. Our NHS has sustained a track record of innovation over the course of the programme in meeting these challenges, including, for example, the launch of the online appointment booking process and the vaccine management tool to record vaccinations. It's exhibited an ability to continually learn from the outcomes of the programme, reflected, for example, in our changing approaches to address low uptake of the vaccine amongst minority groups. We maintain the position that a mandatory domestic certification remains certification scheme remains a necessary and proportionate measure, which will encourage vaccine uptake and allow our higher risk settings to continue to operate as an alternative to closure or more restrictive measures should cases spike again. The NHS COVID Status app, which features a digital record of a user's vaccination status, including a QR code for each vaccination a person has received, went live on the 1st of October, as set out by the First Minister last week. Enforcement provisions obviously do not come into force, come into effect until the 18th of October. Frankly, we are not just aware of those difficulties initially faced, but of course regret and apologise for those difficulties that were faced by some users in setting up the app. We have resolved those issues in the app now. We know is working well. It's also, of course, possible for members of the public to request a paper copy of the vaccination record or to download a PDF version from the NHS Inform website. To conclude, I'm grateful to all organisations and individuals who are working to implement the scheme, as confidence and trust from the public underpins the success of the vaccination programme. The government very much remains committed to upholding transparency and openness around our plans. Members will recall my statement presenting our autumn-winter vaccination plan last week, and Public Health Scotland continues to publish daily vaccination data on their website. To date, we've delivered over 8 million COVID vaccinations in 10 months. With COVID boosters, flu vaccines and jabs for new groups added, We will now need to deliver roughly the same number of vaccines, just slightly under, about 7.5 million over the autumn and winter period alone. A huge job for the NHS. I'd like to end where I started by thanking them for their incredible efforts, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking a few questions. My first question is in relation to the vaccine rollout, and Audit Scotland has commended the progress in vaccinating a large majority of the population, and it states the COVID-19 vaccination program has made excellent progress in vaccinating a large proportion of the adult population. Vaccines have been delivered in a variety of ways to make it easier for more people to access, and there has been a level of vaccine wastage that's been very low. What lessons can we learn from the successes of the vaccine program, both for future vaccine programs and the wider delivery of public services?
Thanks, Convener. It has been a success. I'm really pleased about the Audit Scotland report. I met with the Auditor General just before the report was due to be released, and I know Audit Scotland reports that are quite challenging to the government, and of course they are right to be, and Audit Scotland works independently. They get a lot of attention. I was hoping that this one would also get as much attention, but perhaps it hasn't, because it is really quite remarkable just how positive that Audit Scotland report is. I think the nub of your question is really important. We are doing a lot of work with our partners to try to learn the lessons of that success, and how can we implement it, not just other vaccine programmes, but actually does it tell us how we can do better joint working across a range of programmes that we have. So we have undertaken an exercise that includes interviews with health boards, vaccination leads, and of course many others to try to embed those lessons learned into a future vaccine delivery programme. Some of that learning has evolved. For example, how we reach those groups where uptake hasn't been as high as we'd wanted it to be. What I should also say is that there's good conversations that take place across the four nations as well. I usually meet every week with the other health ministers across the four nations, but certainly our officials meet extremely regularly to see where we can share good practice. And Wales often has been slightly, just to my annoyance sometimes, just slightly ahead of the curve as we've tried to catch them up in vaccines. And often I will speak to the Welsh Health Minister to see if there's anything they're doing that we're not doing. So we're absolutely learning those lessons. And certainly the key point I would suggest would be the ability to mobilise the wider public sector and the third sector, because third sector has also been involved in the vaccine rollout, how to mobilise them at pace and scale. And I think it's probably a good example of what Christie and the Christie Commission spoke about.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We just previously to this a public meeting, we had a private briefing with advisers, which was fascinating. Professor Donnelly from the University of St Andrews has said there was nothing worse than the COVID pandemic that could hit us, but there was one thing that could be worse, which would be the digital technology blackout during the pandemic. So in pandemic preparedness, can you tell me, is there any work going on with the Scottish Government to ensure digital security?
Yes. One of the key meetings I had early on as Health Secretary was with experts in cybersecurity. There's still work to be done there, to be frank, and we've seen these have been aired publicly. There have been some breaches of cybersecurity in relation to health boards previously. So we've got to make sure our systems are robust. Generally, when it comes to our digital tech and infrastructure around the NHS, we've got a way to go. And I'm not just talking about the issues with the COVID app, and I'd be happy to talk to them in more detail, but generally the digital infrastructure, the ambitions that we've got for digital infrastructure are just that, very ambitious. But I think we need to move ahead at scale and at pace. But on the cybersecurity side, we're doing a lot of work with health boards and others to try to bolster our cybersecurity, because it is incredibly important.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Last question. Moving on to the spread of vaccine misinformation, especially on social media, ranging from the Red Cross has banned blood donations from vaccinated people and that death from vaccine has overtaken COVID deaths. Can I ask what the Scottish Government are doing to counteract this misinformation?
So there's a lot going on in the social media space, and what we try to do is get clinicians to lead a lot of that work. But also, it's why we try to use social media influencers as best we possibly can, because a lot of this disinformation spreads on social media, and therefore influencers, by their very name and title, of course, carry significant influence amongst those who are on social media. Sometimes that works well. There are, of course, obvious examples where that doesn't perhaps work as well as we anticipated it to do. I would also caution, I suppose, about thinking about disinformation just in the social media space, because it's not. We have had examples, even in Scotland, where people have rocked up to schools outside the school gate, presenting a letter which looks like it's an NHS information leaflet, but contains a whole host of disinformation. Now, we acted really quickly in that, and were able to speak to the school and able to send communications to the parents of the children involved. But countering disinformation is going to be a multi-pronged approach. Social media and digital is going to have to involve really taking on quite robustly, I think, some of the disinformation that exists. But it's a multi-pronged approach, and frankly an approach globally we're all trying to deal with. What I am pleased to see in some social media sites, so if I thought about it, Instagram, for example, if you're talking about COVID-19, it says quite clearly that whether or not that information is secure or not, and I think it's Instagram, forgive me, I'm on quite a lot of platforms, but I think it's on Instagram where that information is certified or not. So I think we should encourage our social media companies actually to do a bit more in this and to tackle disinformation where they can.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I move to Murdo Fraser?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. My question really follows on quite neatly from the Convener's last question, because I wanted to ask you about the issue of vaccine hesitancy. And this committee's taken evidence from experts around these issues. There's a difference between anti-vaxxers and the vaccine hesitant, as you will know. So anti-vaxxers are people who are ideologically opposed to vaccination, and nothing will persuade them otherwise. They just don't trust the authorities. But the vaccine hesitant are a different group, people who perhaps have hesitation about vaccine but are not intrinsically opposed. And I'm really interested in trying to explore what more is being done to try and encourage the vaccine hesitant to take up vaccination. Now, if we look at the data we've been provided with, some of the vaccine hesitant are young people, but the most stark difference is in terms of ethnicity. So, for example, according to the latest figures, the percentage of the white population who have had two doses of vaccine is just under 80%. Amongst people of black origin, it's just 52%. Amongst people of Asian origin, it's 64%. So quite substantial gaps. So I suppose my question is, what is being done by the Scottish Government to understand the reasons for this vaccine hesitancy amongst ethnic groups? Is there anything we can learn from other countries, other parts of the UK, for example, in terms of, are their figures different? Are they better from ours? And what more is being done in terms of tackling these groups?
Yeah, so I think it's an exceptionally important question from Murdo Fraser, and I also agree with the premise of your question that there is a difference between vaccine hesitancy and those who are anti-vax. And I think it's really important that we don't stigmatise people that have legitimate questions about the vaccine. And that's probably particularly important when it comes to the 12 to 15-year-olds. I'm a stepfather of a 12-year-old, and OK, I know more about the vaccine given the nature of my role. But when it comes to your children, people are naturally going to have more questions and potentially even more hesitancy. So it's really important that whole informed consent process that we have allows a parent or a carer to go into a vaccine clinic to speak to a vaccinator to ask very legitimate questions. And actually, the anecdotal evidence, certainly when I've been speaking to health boards, is that we are seeing parents asking a lot of questions, and children themselves asking a lot of questions, and I've been very buoyed by the fact that vaccinators tend to engage with the young person themselves to say, well, do you have any questions at all? And I'm happy to answer them. So I think Murdo Fraser is absolutely right to premise his question by making that distinction. On the substance of the point that you raise, again, a lot of work has been done to try to understand vaccine hesitancy. Amongst ethnic minority groups, and I'll come to young people, although there is obviously an intersectionality there, but in terms of the ethnic minority population and community, we've been helped a lot by the good work that BMIS has done, Black and Ethnic Minority Infrastructure Scotland. They have created and lead a group, forgive me, I can't remember right from the top of my head the name of the group, but bring in a variety of people who represent a number of ethnic minority populations. I've spoken to that group as well to try to understand myself where some of the hesitancy exists. There was a number of representatives from the Black and African communities, as well as the Polish and also the Gypsy Traveller community, who were giving me some really helpful feedback. So what we've managed to do with that feedback is try to make our vaccine more accessible to those groups. So we've gone to, for example, taking mobile units to the Gurdwara, the Sikh Gurdwara. We've gone to churches where we know the Black African communities will go to in large numbers, for example. So we've tried to do that. We've obviously also translated material into a number of languages now. Tried to use community influencers and, again, clinicians, again, from the South Asian community, for example, I know that came together, and from the Muslim community I saw that came together to produce a video to use both clinicians, but also what I thought was quite smart, to use faith leaders who we know, again, can have a fair degree of influence amongst a number of groups as well. In terms of young people, again, we've tried to speak directly to young people to understand some of the reasons why they're vaccine hesitant. If I can give Murdo Fraser one example of how we used that useful intelligence, we noted quite early on that once we went into the 18 to 29 year old age bracket, a fair degree of the feedback we were getting was around people's concerns and around fertility. So people were at that age group trying for, wanted to try for a baby. They were worried about the vaccine impact. And therefore, we really boosted the communications around, actually, this is recommended for you if you're pregnant, but also it has no effect at all on fertility, and really try to target that communication on social media and online as well.
Thanks very much. That was a very comprehensive answer. I suppose the one issue you didn't really touch on, and I'm interested whether you have any data on this, is whether in other parts of the UK there's any difference in these figures. Are you aware?
Forgive me. Yeah, forgive me, you're right. I didn't touch upon that. I don't have that to hand. I don't know if any of my officials have that to hand. I would be surprised if we differed greatly, but I don't know if Karen Duffy or Derek Grieve might have more information in that regard. But if not, we can obviously come back to committee and write to the convener.
I don't know that to hand, Cabinet Secretary. We can, of course, provide it, but I can reassure the committee that we do have regular discussions with our colleagues across the four nations and share learning, and that has included how we've all tackled underrepresented groups.
Okay, well, thanks very much. I mean, if you get some more data, that I think would be interesting. Can I ask one more issue, convener, that again touches on all this, and that's we've had a lot of conversations, as you know, about the whole issue of vaccine passports now. The committee took evidence last week from Professor Stephen Riker and two of his colleagues, who all raised the same issue about the concerns about a backfire effect from making vaccine passports compulsory in certain circumstances, and how when you're dealing with a vaccine hesitant, this actually could have the unintended consequence of making some people who are starting from a position of being distrustful of authority, making it less likely they would take up the vaccine. And they all made the point that, you know, Scotland is the only country in Europe that now requires vaccine passports as the price of entry to certain events without giving the alternative of providing a negative COVID test, which every other country does. And their view was that allowing that alternative would deal with that issue of the backfire impact. So is that not something the Scottish Government has given serious thought to, given that you've got these experts saying this is a real worry?
And those experts are people that we engage with regularly, and Professor Stephen Ryker in particular, somebody when he speaks carries considerable weight. And so, of course, we do consider this. The First Minister has said that we would not rule out the potential for a negative test in the future. The reason why we are not introducing it upon implementation and introduction of the scheme is that an unsupervised LFT, you know, that can be abused, and therefore people can gain entry by falsifying an unsupervised LFD. So we're trying to make the scheme upon implementation as stringent as it possibly can. I don't take away from what Stephen Ryker or nor actually what Murdo Fraser says in terms of potentially those that are vaccine resistant and then entrenching that. So it's something we're going to keep a really close eye on. We will evaluate the impact of the vaccine certification scheme. We'll do that through a variety of data sources. So that will include information on vaccines. So do we see an uptick in the vaccine rate? And initially, you know, when we announced the vaccine or intention for a vaccine certification scheme, we did see a rise, particularly amongst the younger age group. But we'll keep that under review. We'll look at other metrics, as you'd imagine we would, case numbers, hospital beds, ICU occupancy, but also the wider societal and economic impacts. These are all matters that we will consider on a very regular basis. And of course, Murdo Fraser knows we'll review every 3 weeks the scheme as well, and we'll continue to engage with stakeholders. But the points Murdo Fraser and Dr. Ryker make are ones that we're very aware of, very conscious of, and we'll keep a close eye on.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I move to Jim Fairley?
Thank you, Convener. On the good response that we're now getting from a younger generation, do you have figures to tell us what effect the vaccine passport actually had on increasing the uptake of the vaccine? Delighted to hear that you are doing work to get into the ethnic communities where there is hesitancy in not getting the vaccine. But is there any monitoring or measuring going on as that messaging develops? Does it increase the uptake so that we know why that there was hesitancy in the first place, and are we overcoming that hesitancy? And in terms of the issue around misinformation, people are entitled to their opinion, but they're not entitled to their own facts. Do we need legislation to stop people putting information out that we know to be factually incorrect but is dangerous to public health?
So a number of questions and very good questions in around this. Obviously, the Republic of Ireland was ahead of us in terms of their own COVID certification scheme, and I noticed an article in the BBC, I think it was just last week, talking about the fact that there was an expert saying there that if it wasn't for the COVID certification scheme, uptake would have been much lower. That was an immunology expert that said that. And Professor Kingston Mills from Trinity College Dublin said that the scheme had been a quote-unquote big incentive for people to get jabbed. In terms of Scotland's own figures, we'll keep that under very, very close review. But in the 2 weeks after the announcement that we made on the 1st of September, there was a 10% increase in the uptake of the vaccine between in the 18 to 29 year old age group, of course, which is the age group that has the younger the age group, the less the uptake tends to be. So that was positive. So we'll keep that under review, of course. In terms of the uptake, the groups where the uptake is lower, so both in terms of younger age groups, but also minority ethnic groups, but also actually the third group is if you are from a more deprived area, you're likely to have lower uptake. So we will monitor those groups as the vaccine certification scheme embeds, and we're hoping that it increases. But I think the important point to raise, and I'm sure some of the advisors you would have spoken to would have raised this point, is clearly, you know, anything we can do to increase the uptake is going to be really important, because we don't want those groups that have a lower uptake not to go to live events, not to go to late venues, not to go to the football, etc. So we're working really hard to make sure that the information around certification is, for example, translated into other languages, and so on and so forth. In terms of your last question, we're not planning for legislation at this point. And I think we'll do everything we can to try to counter misinformation without going down a legislative route for a number of reasons, partly because legislation takes time, and we want to try to counter that just now, but clearly it's a matter we would keep under review.
Come one last point on that. Going back to the groups who do not, who have a natural tendency not to want to get vaccinated, we've spoken in this committee before that a good chunk of those groups won't necessarily go to the football and whatever. And one thing we've discussed regularly is the messaging. So the messaging that has been targeted at these particular groupings. I'd just be interested to know if once that messaging goes into these groups, does that then increase the uptake in the vaccine so that we know that the messaging is getting through?
Yeah, look, the cause and effect can also, causation can be quite difficult to absolutely prove definitively. But certainly, I know our messaging when, for example, we've made a real targeted approach to 18 to 29-year-olds, to young people, the feedback has been at least positive. But I'll see if we can get anything, we can write back to the convener to distribute to other committee members if we can give you something a bit more certain around causation. But that can be difficult to prove. I would also just say to domestic, I don't think there's any group that has a natural tendency not to get vaccinated. I think the even amongst those groups where the vaccine is lower, it's still high, which is positive. It's lower than other groups. I think what we've got to do is make sure we're continuing to try to make the vaccine as accessible as we possibly can to those individuals where the uptake is lower. And I think, you know, when as restrictions ease, as case numbers thankfully are beginning to reduce, I think we've got a challenge there to try to tell people, look, you've still got to get vaccinated. You know, just because life is getting back to some sort of normality, thankfully, this is an unpredictable virus and there could be future spikes and you don't want to be unprotected. And the figures speak for themselves for those that are hospitalised and then become seriously ill in terms of those who are vaccinated versus those who are unvaccinated. Well, the figures tell their own story.
If I may, Professor Nicholas Steedman would like to come in.
Just to add to the Cabinet Secretary's answer there, and just to embellish that a little bit, we monitor very carefully the impact that we're having in terms of changes to the vaccination programme on the groups where we know classically and historically uptake is lower, such as those associated with higher levels of deprivation and also some of the ethnic minority groups. Some of the things that we've done to counter that, you know very well, for example, taking the vaccine to people and taking the vaccine to places where we know that those groups may be more hesitant. And that's clearly monitored. We can see whether taking vaccine to those groups does result in an increase in uptake. And that's something that our vaccine inclusiveness steering group keeps a very close eye on. Some of the things that we do know that work are having local champions, having people with whom these groups identify, giving them the information about vaccination. And so that's something that we've employed across our groups where we think vaccine uptake might be lower than we would want it to be. And that has been shown in many other behavioural studies to be one of the most effective things to do. And the other thing that we do, of course, is we share learning across the boards in Scotland so that if one board has a measure in a particular group that's worked really well, the way that we work across Scotland is so tight and so inclusive that learning is shared through our vaccine programme board across the whole of Scotland in order to increase uptake. And as the Cabinet Secretary also mentioned earlier, we are in the midst of a lessons learned investigation and report along with Public Health Scotland about our vaccination programme, including the inclusiveness element and whether there are particular measures that we've undertaken that have been more successful at increasing uptake in some of these groups than others. So I think along with the Cabinet Secretary, we can absolutely assure you that from the clinical point of view, this is first and foremost for us in the vaccine programme and that there's an extensive programme of work to support increasing inclusiveness, including monitoring what does and doesn't work. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Steedman. Can I move to Alex Raleigh?
Thank you. Can I pick on a couple of things? In the last few weeks, I've met with frontline staff in the NHS. I've also met with trade union representatives for the frontline. Now, the announcement you made yesterday, whilst welcome, they would argue does not go far enough, should have been earlier, but more importantly, does not go far enough in terms of the resources needed. They also, some of the feedback that I've had is that the pressure is immense. There are times when they say, their words, the hospitals are not safe, that the nurse-patient ratio is way beyond what is acceptable. So do you have a grasp of the extent of the problems that we actually have in our hospitals? And do you accept what these nurses and trade unions are saying, that there are questions here about the level of safety and whether the numbers of nurses are so low compared to the number of patients that there are serious safety issues within our hospitals?
So maybe, Convener, to answer questions in and around my statement last week. So first thing to say is that when any of our trade unions speak up and speak out, they'll be listened by this government. I spoke to the trade unions last week in relation to my statement. I spoke to them before when I made my statement also in around additional funding for the ambulance services. So I speak to trade unions quite regularly, and you talked about nursing. I spoke to the RCN Friday, I think, that just passed. So we'll speak regularly, engage regularly with trade unions and take very seriously what they say. Yes, would be the answer to your question. I and we, the government, have a grasp of just how serious the situation is across our NHS and social care. I think it's really important not just to talk about the pressure in hospitals. There is significant pressure in our hospitals, but also across social care as well. It's why the funding announcement that I made, which is the biggest winter pressure package ever announced in the history of devolution, and so it should be thus, because the significance of the pressure, I would argue, in this winter is more than any other winter we've faced, not just in devolution, but probably in the NHS's 73-year existence. So this will go a long way, I would hope, in making an impact, not just again in terms of the acute side, but in primary care, but also in social care in the community as well. In terms of your specific questions, any concerns around patient safety, I would hope would be flagged up to the government, to the health board, of course, initially, but to the government as well. We have the highest record level of staffing in the NHS ever under any government by this government. We'll continue to recruit. And of course, my statement made significant ambitions around recruitment, not just for nurses, but also band twos to fours as well. But I have to be upfront with the member and with the public. These measures will help to mitigate some of the challenges, but we're still in for an incredibly, incredibly difficult winter. Clinicians tell me that their real concern is not just the COVID pressures, but we hope to make a significant dent into those as we're controlling transmission, but the flu and other respiratory viruses, because our immunity, we suspect, is quite low because of last year. Of course, there wasn't the flu wasn't circulating as much due to the lockdown and restrictive measures we were under. The concern is that the immunity of people is low. So what I would say to Mr. Early to finish off my remarks would be every single penny we're getting, whether it's through additional consequentials on health and social care, I can promise him and the trade unions and the public, most importantly, that we'll spend those on health and social care. We should get more clarity on the level of those consequentials after the UK government spending review, which I think is the 27th of October. And if there are additional funds that come to health and social care, I promise him we will get those out the door as soon as possible.
I have raised the social care issues with the First Minister and Deputy First Minister over the last few weeks, and I actually think unless we actually put in a much more focused task force, I'm not sure the capacity exists within the current management setups of these health and social care partnerships to deliver, but that's for another day. Can I come on to the issue of the health harms of COVID? I mean, do you accept that more people will die of preventative or could have been prevented cancers and other health harms this winter, and that's the knock-on effect of COVID. And how do you balance that up where we're focused on COVID, but actually these other health harms that are in the community? And I'll just add that to the statement that you made, I think, with Andrew Bust, that I read, where about GPs, because I have first-hand experience from constituents that were not able to get a GP appointment, ended up through another route at the hospital, and were severely ill, and had they not got to hospital. So there are real harms out there. Now, and I would want to sort of qualify that by saying I understand before COVID there was masses of good work going on in health centres around triaging people, and I'm not suggesting we suddenly go back to that. To everybody has to get a face-to-face appointment. But surely where people feel that they are so ill they need a face-to-face appointment, there has to be some kind of guarantee in place. And how is our NHS going to cope with that? Because it seems to me that the threat of death now doesn't come so much for COVID, but it comes from the knock-on effect on all these other health ills that have not been dealt with as a result of the focus on COVID.
Thank Mr. Rowley for... I think a series of very good questions, comprehensive questions. So I can take a few of them down, and forgive me if I've missed anything, then just come back to me. I was trying to jot away as you were speaking. He's right. COVID has direct impacts and it has indirect health impacts. So the direct impacts are still, I'm afraid, being felt by families up and down the country, and Mr. Rowley's own constituency and my constituency. I can't preempt today's figures that they'll be out later today, but it won't be a surprise. There'll be a number of families that will be devastated because they've lost another family member. They've lost a family member to COVID, and those numbers are still too high. And again, my condolences, and I think everybody's condolences still go out. We could probably all tell stories of people that either in our own families, unfortunately, or people that we know that have lost somebody who's been bereaved by COVID. So it's important to say that those impacts are still with us. The second point that he makes about indirect consequences of COVID, he's absolutely right. There's no getting away from the fact that governments right across the world, including across the rest of the UK, had to make exceptionally difficult decisions. I think the toughest decision we probably had to make as a government collectively was at the beginning of the pandemic, when we paused cancer screenings, some cancer screenings. And of course, we resumed them as soon as we could in August 2020, if my memory serves me correct. But those were the tough, tough decisions. And even now, health boards, again, in Mr. Rowley's own constituency, are having to make really difficult decisions about pausing elective surgery. For example, I have a family member who himself has been waiting for surgery, understands, of course, the reasons why it hasn't been able to take place. And okay, his pain can be managed at home, but it's difficult. It's difficult to see that family member having to manage that pain. I suspect, again, Mr. Rowley will have stories from constituents, maybe even within his own family, where he could recount similar type of stories. So, yes, we are very aware. And, in fact, the pressures on our hospital right now that Mr. Rowley referenced in his first question to me, I think are more to do with the indirect issues that COVID causes. Now, there's still just under 1,000 COVID patients in hospital, or patients in hospital with COVID. So they are taking up over 900 beds at the moment within our hospitals. And that will hopefully come down as COVID transmission is controlled. But actually, the significant pressure, if you talk to any nurse, doctor, you know, anybody within an acute setting, but also actually anybody even within the primary care setting, will tell you it's that demand, that pent-up demand for people who didn't see a GP or go to hospital for 18 months. Their pain has got worse. They're now presenting with higher acuity. It means they're staying in hospital for longer. That's taking up bed space, of course, et cetera, et cetera. So the points he raises are ones that we're very, very familiar with. It's why we've taken the decisions we've taken in terms of my winter announcement yesterday, because what we have to try to do, and this is before the onset of the flu season, is try to free up and maximise capacity as best we possibly can. Mr. Rowley, I think, raised this at FMQs
a couple of weeks ago with the First Minister. I thought it was a very good point that he raised. Or sorry, it may have been during her ministerial statement. He made the point that if you invest in social care, which is where the significant amount of my announcement has gone into that funding social care, then we can hopefully free up capacity by those who are clinically safe to discharge, but taking up at the moment, you know, around about 1,500 beds in our hospitals, safely discharge them into the community, then it's better for the entire system as a whole. But those were tough decisions to make, and every government had to make them right across the country. The Welsh government, you know, I speak to Ellen Ed Morgan fairly regularly. The Welsh government had to make decisions like that. The UK government, and of course the Northern Irish too. In terms of his point on GP face-to-face appointments, he references the communication I've sent out jointly with the BMA. He'll see very clearly in black and white in that communication, I say, that notwithstanding, of course, the fact that we want to see a hybrid model, we want to see a hybrid model continue because it works for a lot of people. If I gave my own example, a number of weeks ago now, last month, or no, it was August time, I had an eczema flare-up. It was helpful for me to be able to phone the doctor in between meetings and get the ointment and the cream that I needed sent to the pharmacist, the prescription sent to the pharmacist, and pick it up later on in the afternoon. That meant I didn't have to take out time to get an appointment, to go face-to-face, etc., etc. So for some people, the hybrid model works well. Some people want a telephone appointment, want a video consultation. But what I say very clearly in that communication with Dr. Buist, jointly with Dr. Buist, is that given the changes in the guidance that recently got published by Public Health Scotland, I would expect to see an increase in face-to-face appointment. That's the desire of the government. But also that has to be done in a way that is the decision of the clinician. And neither me nor Mr. Rowley should be the ones who determine when an individual or patient should be seen face-to-face. But I agree with the premise of his point that, of course, if an individual requires a face-to-face appointment, absolutely they should get a face-to-face appointment.
Just going back on that point, because my experience has been, like yours, being able to get a phone call, indeed, for there a doctor saying, no, I want to see you. So my experience has not been bad. But I have real examples very within my family as well as others,
yes,
where people have been told, no, you can take antibiotics, whatever, and then ended up at hospital, and that advice, and that was completely wrong. So there's a question between clinical judgment of a GP or somebody within a health centre to be able to say to the individual that they're making a clinical judgment, that they're not to see anybody. But when you hear stories, and I'm sure there's many more, I certainly have seen it firsthand, where someone's refused an appointment and told they can get antibiotics, they end up hours later in the hospital anyway, and they've got something seriously wrong with them, then there is a duty on you or not to ensure that that cannot happen. And it's getting that balance right, and I'm not sure simply making reference that you and I are not the clinical experts on this is the right balance. People should be able to get a face-to-face appointment of some sort if they are so ill that they feel they need that, surely.
Yes, I would agree with that. I would hope that the vast majority of GPs would do that if they believe that somebody is potentially going to become seriously ill. Then I would hope that they would see them face to face. My expectation, in fact, is that that would be the case. Now, two things I would say. One, the data that we get from GPs, I want to see a significant improvement on. As soon as I came into post, it was one of the things that became very clear to me, is that the data that we're getting from, and GPs are independent contractors and we have to respect the model and so et cetera, et cetera. I fully accept all of that, but the data could be better. And in fact, my conversations with the BMA, the RCGP, they agree with those points. There doesn't seem to be any point of contention around improving the data. And secondly, it's why I sent a letter jointly with Dr. Buist, because Dr. Buist, of course, is a clinician. He's a GP in Blairgowrie, and I am, of course, the non-clinician, but I have the responsibility for the health service. But I wanted it to be joint because Dr. Buist carries a great degree of respect, rightly so, as being a clinician, but also his role within the BMA, to say that our joint expectation, and that's the words that we use in the communication, our joint expectation is that face-to-face GP appointments should increase given now the change in guidance. But I can promise Mr. Rowley, it's something I'm keeping a very, very close eye on quite regularly. What I would say is unhelpful, I know Alex Riley is absolutely not doing this, but what I would say would be unhelpful. Would be trying to pick kind of one part of the health service against another part of the health service, saying, you know, because GPs aren't seeing people face to face, therefore, you know, we're having to pick up the demand in A&E now. I just want to caution against doing that, but also caution against anybody suggesting, and again, I know Alex Riley is not suggesting this, but any suggestion that GPs have not been seeing patients at all and been refusing to see them at all and being closed during the pandemic. They've dealt with quite a high volume of cases, and you know, the Conservative spokesperson, health spokesperson, of course, is himself a practicing GP and will speak, speaks quite powerfully about the caseload that he himself is dealing with, let alone other GPs too. So I think the points Alex Riley raises, there's not much between him and I and what he says. I would just ask that everybody exercises a bit of caution around this discussion.
Thank you, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning to your staff. I've got three questions, really, but really on the back of the Convener's question, or suggestion that the number one threat to the health of the nation, if you like, and to business, is actually if the data gathering and the digital cybersecurity issue became serious. So on the back of that, and I want to look ahead in terms of COVID recovery, probably further ahead than currently when we're talking about. I'm really interested around the impact of other health conditions on the COVID death rates. I think we are aware that conditions like obesity and diabetes and heart disease and COPD have a significant impact on the COVID death rate. And I'm wondering whether or not it's time to rationalise that. Maybe this is the time to draw a line in the sand and make a significant step forward in the preventative health agenda, in that tackling things like obesity, tackling things like diabetes, will have the biggest impact on future death rates in COVID and potentially other pandemics similar to that. And I wonder what work the Scottish Government are doing or considering around that particular issue.
I think it's an excellent question. I'm not sure I'd phrase it in the same way in terms of drawing the kind of line in the sand, but what I would say is prior to COVID, I think this government, and in fairness, the Parliament, because we worked quite well, I think quite collaboratively across parties in the public health agenda, and there was significant progress that was being made. Excuse me. So we know there was significant progress being made in terms of smoking cessation. I don't need to go into the details of why that's so important when it comes to preventable deaths. Good progress being made, certainly in terms of ambition around obesity. And I should say again that I know is shared. Shared Four Nations agenda. It's an issue that I've raised Four Nations with other health ministers as well. And although we have some issues with the UK Health and Care Bill, I think some of what they're trying to introduce around tackling public health, particularly around obesity, unhealthy food, on a point of principle and policy, actually, is one that I agree with. So what, though, has undoubtedly been the case is that because of the pandemic and our focus on COVID, we've had to perhaps pause some of the good work that was being done previously, and certainly a lot of the marketing and communications, as we've already spoken about, the focus has absolutely been on COVID and getting information out about COVID, whether it was around vaccines or previously around, of course, good hygiene measures, et cetera, et cetera. What I think has to be done, and I was speaking to Public Health Scotland about this in the not-too-distant past, that we have to try to, which is what I think Brian Whittle's alluding to, is we have to try to pivot back to some of those really core and important public health messages, because he's right, the outcomes could be worse for you in terms of COVID if you have other underlying health conditions, and we have to understand the data about that a bit better, and Professor Steedman from a clinical perspective could speak more to that. And so, yes, we will have to try to pivot back to those important public health initiatives and communications. What I would just say to Brian Whittle, I know he understands this fully, is we're not out of the pandemic, still in the midst of the pandemic. You know, we're still, again, without preempting today's figures, I think if I looked at yesterday's figures, you know, we're still heading anywhere between 2,000 to 3,000 cases a day, which is still extraordinarily high. In fact, you know, if it wasn't for the vaccine, and the effects of the vaccine, then if we saw such high case numbers a year ago, we'd be in lockdown. So, we're still in the midst of that pandemic.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I think we probably are broadly aligned with the line of questioning that I'm going on here. But as I say, I'm looking ahead, looking at how we come out the other side of this. I think the COVID has actually exacerbated problems. I think we've got increased levels of obesity, and that brings me on to my second part of my question, is the increased pressure on the NHS, and that is part of the jigsaw. Without question. I was struck by one of our previous panels suggesting, for example, in terms of mental health, the worst way to tackle mental health is to firefight and then end up having to treat with drugs. And I think I asked the Cabinet Secretary this particular question the other day then around staffing issues, which again have been exacerbated by COVID. There are many more absentees within our health service than would be normal. We have many more students applying for medical courses than are currently offered in our universities and colleges. So in terms of long-term planning and the COVID recovery, it will require significant workforce planning. So I wonder where the Scottish Government are with collecting that kind of data, looking ahead to what the demand will be and how you're going to match that demand with obviously a further increase in staffing.
The NHS Recovery Plan, which is our plan for the next 5 years, backed, as the member knows, by £1 billion of investment, provides a high-level overview. So what do we intend to do in terms of increased capacity, in terms of inpatients, outpatients, diagnostics, cancer, mental health, and so on and so forth. So it provides that high-level overview, and I won't rehearse what's in that recovery plan. It's obviously available for you and others to see. I think the point about long-term planning is really, really important, because we do have an immediate challenge, immediate crisis, immediate pressures on the NHS and right across social care as well. And so we're dealing with those. But it would be wrong not to think about the long term. This is why we've committed to a workforce strategy by the end of the calendar year. And of course, trade unions, staff side representatives are going to be integral in helping us to understand that. And we'll need to show a degree of flexibility, because quite frankly speaking, we don't know fully the impacts, the indirect health impacts that Alex Riley spoke about of COVID-19 yet, because as I keep saying, we're still in the midst of that pandemic. I think everything that Brian Whittle says is absolutely right about the health impacts and the scale of the challenge we're facing. And it's why I often say in the chamber that this is the biggest shock. COVID-19 is the biggest shock our NHS has faced in 73 years, because it's not just the direct impact of COVID, which is huge and significant in its own right, it's the indirect impacts, which are going to take years. And it's why I'm always doing my best to be up front with the public and saying, we can't expect to solve these problems in the space of weeks or even a couple of months. It's going to take years. That's why our recovery plan is a 5-year plan. I think on the points he raised last week around the number of entrants into specific courses, it's something that we're working really hard with schools, with higher and further education institutes on. Our fill rate is good, as we saw from statistics released recently, but if you kind of dig deeper into those statistics at a more granular level, you begin to see, and I think Brian Whittle raised this the questions last week, you begin to see where actually we need to do a little bit more work. And I think he's right to raise those issues. On mental health, the only two things I would say to him, there's just simply no doubt that mental health challenges have been exacerbated by the pandemic. Not to say there weren't challenges before, there were significant challenges before. But they've been exacerbated. Even in my own constituency, I'm quite saddened to say, over the course of the pandemic, the number of people and young people that have completed suicide, I haven't seen that in my constituency certainly in past years, and it's been extremely saddening. And I think probably other members could say the same. The second point I'd make is, although we're funding in crisis intervention, so our CAMHS, our children's and adult mental health services. Children, adolescent mental health services, we're also funding pre-crisis, because we don't want to wait to just crisis. So we're trying to fund other interventions and initiatives in a community level to stop people getting to that crisis point.
Sorry, can I bring in Professor Steedman, who wishes to comment?
Thank you very much. Just responding to the Cabinet Secretary's mention that I might be able to add some more information about what we are doing in terms of those underlying determinants of public health and underlying determinants of health, for example, exercise and diet and alcohol issues. So I would absolutely concur with the statement that many of these underlying determinants of health have been worsened and have been polarized more with the COVID pandemic. And we often find that pandemics affect those whose underlying health is most poor in the first place. We're acutely aware of that. And health improvement in terms of those underlying determinants of health is one of the pillars of our recovery strategy from COVID for Scotland. So the committee will be very well aware of the Remobilise, Recover, Redesign programme, through which we have four different programmes of work. But just to highlight that one of those is specifically to do with proactive and preventative care. In other words, addressing those fundamental determinants, underlying determinants of health. So this is something that we take so importantly that we've devoted, in fact, one of our four major programmes of care to this going forwards. And the CMO's report this year, again, highlighted his particular commitment to focusing on the inequalities of health in Scotland. Largely, those are determined by those underlying reasons for poor public health. So we're going to be supported in this endeavour in the proactive and preventative care approach by our national public health body, Public Health Scotland, who've highlighted many of the domains within this health improvement programme in their delivery plan of from 21 to 2024. So there certainly is a great awareness amongst us as clinicians in government and also the ministers, including the Cabinet Secretary. And we are highlighting this as a really important issue going forwards, not just in terms of recovery from the pandemic, but also to improve the public health of the people of Scotland across the board and to increase our life expectancy, which we know before the pandemic was probably one of the worst in Europe. So it's a huge issue that the committee member has raised, and rightly so. Thank you.
I think the Cabinet Secretary obviously quite right talks about the acute response required currently to COVID. And I think, and I would you know, it can't be overstated how important that is. But what I'm trying to look at is how we move after that, where we move after that. I think, you know, back to where we started here around data gathering, I think what would be really interesting and why data is so important is a sort of a longer term study of the impact of COVID. Things like, you know, I'm quite interested around the BAME community, for example, and the impact on the BAME community and the fact that we have less of a BAME community up here than it is down south, and has that had an impact on the numbers? Our overall health, we have a fairly poor health record in Scotland, and what that impact has had on it, and ethnicity, the uptake of the vaccine we've talked about before, and SIMD, the variation around the SIMD areas, and you know, if we look at perhaps even right at the very start, the reaction of governments as a whole, as the virus made its way across the world, I think we would all agree that governments as a whole didn't react as quickly as they could have. So it's gathering all that data. So in all of that there, I said my question would be, where are we in terms of data gathering and pulling all that together to, one, look at how we come out the other side of this and how we prevent as much as we possibly can something similar happening in the future?
I think these are excellent questions and very good points being raised by Brian Whittle. So we are doing a lot of that work. We have been guided in a lot of our consideration around ethnic minority communities by an expert group
was being led by Christina McKelvey, which is obviously on a period of curative leave at the moment, and other ministers are taking over that work, but involved a number of organisations across Scotland, would be very familiar to Brian Whittle and committee members who represent our ethnic minority communities, and they've given a number of recommendations to government. I think they have been published, forgive me, I'll need to double check that. I think they have been published, but so much of, or so many of their recommendations focus on data. And we are not where we want to be on data, particularly amongst our ethnic minority communities. And that's government-wide, public sector-wide. I remember in Justice, when I was speaking about justice outcomes for our ethnic minority communities, we didn't have the data quite that we wanted at the granular level. So a lot of work is going into improving data, particularly amongst our ethnic minority communities. I think the points Brian Whittle raises, I wouldn't disagree with at all. I do think some of the data, some of the studies that are being done across the UK are ones that we would take a real great interest in. But I would just say there can be even some nuanced differences between Scotland and, for example, England when it comes to, again, BAME communities. Just to give you my own experience absolutely is that there's a difference between the South Asian Pakistani community in Scotland that is different to if you were to go to see the Pakistani English community in Bradford, for example. And I'm never quite sure I've got to the nub of the reasons why, but there's differences in terms of the economic status and so on and so forth. We've just got to be aware of those. Lots of good studies being done globally. We not just take an interest in them, we actively try to seek out what studies are ongoing and what we can learn from those. But I think Brian Whittle's central point around data is not one that I would disagree with. And I would say we are doing a lot of work to try to improve our data collection and all of this for the longer term to inform our response in the future.
Thank you. John Mason.
Thanks very much, convener. If I could return to vaccines for a little while. The whole question of the different vaccines and the impact they're having, and the suggestion was made quite a long time ago that it might be beneficial to mix vaccines, and so people got two different ones, or maybe the third one would be different from the first two. I just wondered if we're any further forward with that.
So I'm probably better letting Professor Steedman come in on this point in a second. So when we look at the booster programme at the moment, there is a study called the COVBoost clinical trial. And that has informed undoubtedly, or the preliminary results have informed the JCVI's advice in that regard. And that's why for the booster dose, we're using mRNA vaccines, so Pfizer or Moderna. I don't think the results have been published yet, but I think they will be published later on this month. By the appropriate bodies, so yes, that is ongoing. I suppose just to throw into the mix, there's a number of clinical trials obviously underway with vaccines that aren't currently being used. Before I overreach too much, I think I'm probably better bringing in Professor Steedman on that.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So there is a lot of data emerging now on the mixing of different types of vaccines, and this is important for a variety of different reasons. It will simplify rollout of a vaccination programme if it's possible to mix and match different vaccines, for example. But more importantly, the mixing and matching and matching of different vaccines may produce a greater clinical response to the relative vaccines, and that's really what we've been focusing on. So as the Cabinet Secretary said, he's absolutely correct. The recent JCVI advice on the preferential selection of mRNA vaccines for the booster programme is based on that mix and match data, which suggests that if you boost with an mRNA vaccine, so that's at the moment the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines in the UK, then you get an incredibly good response to that, a really high antibody level response, and you get a potentially a more broad response as well. So that's precisely why that data has been used to inform the vaccination programme. It's important to note that both of the types of vaccines that we use in the UK for the primary vaccination programme, the AstraZeneca and also then the mRNA vaccines, are incredibly good at preventing severe disease. They both are, because I know that there's often been some concern in the public about which vaccine they're getting and whether they're getting a good vaccine or a not so good vaccine. Both of those vaccines are incredibly good at preventing hospitalisation and severe disease, and we're very fortunate to have them. But in terms of the booster, it does look as if whether you've had an mRNA as your primary course or the AstraZeneca, so the adenovirus, as your primary course, that an mRNA booster seems to produce a really, really high response. And so that's why that has been used for the boost programme. So again, not to labour the complexity of it, there are differences between a primary course of vaccination, i.e. the two doses, or in some cases, the three doses that give you that initial priming response, and then what you use for a booster. So at the moment, we're still recommending that in most cases, when you have your primary course, that it's with the same vaccine for those two doses, but the booster is the mRNA. And the final thing I think to note about the mixing of different types of vaccines is the other thing that's closely monitored is whether if you give different types of vaccine to one individual, that produces different or greater side effects potentially, because that's clearly something again that the public are rightly concerned about. And so again, it's incredibly complex with a number of different different ways that we can administer the mix of vaccines. But what we are ideally looking for is the best possible immune response with the least side effects for someone. And so that's why these are mixed and matched and recommended in the way that they are currently, that you get the same primary course because that minimizes your side effects, but then the boost gives you the greater overall effect and broader protection, whilst also trying to minimise any increased side effects that people might have from mixing the vaccines.
Okay, well, I appreciate that answer. It was quite detailed. That was good. I mean, I'm just wondering, because I've got a couple of constituents, and I don't know if this is typical or not, but, I mean, for example, somebody in their 50s who's refusing to have AstraZeneca, they want Pfizer. And that Pfizer was not approved for that age group, or at least could have been given to that age group, but was used for the others. I've also got somebody, a younger person, who went to a drop-in and got Moderna the first time and can't find somewhere else that's promising Moderna the second time. So, I mean, I'm just wondering if we were... That's two people that could be fully vaccinated if there was a bit more flexibility, but on the other hand, you know, we don't want to be too flexible. So I just wonder how you would react to that kind of situation.
Yeah, I think, and I should say actually before I answer the question, if there are particular issues that you require the health board to look at, then obviously you contact the health board. But if you wanted me to also explore as health secretary, then of course I'd be happy to explore as health secretary. So a couple of things. You're right, there's a balance. We want to get as many people fully vaccinated as possible. But if we, of course, had a policy of everybody's allowed to choose their own vaccine, there could be real supply issues, which we'd be really worried about and concerned about. So we've got to try to find that balance. I know that when initially some of the data came out in around AstraZeneca and those that are under 40 and you know, again, potential for side effects, particularly in relation to blood clots, then there were a number of people who, even if they were over 40, were wanting to choose Pfizer, and we had to take quite a robust line, because otherwise we would have really run into supply issues. But again, I think we've got the balance right at the moment, and that's probably justified if you look at what I'm saying is justified if you look at the figures of the percentage of people that are fully vaccinated. But again,
mop up these remaining ones.
Yes, I take your point. I think it's a good point, but I think we've got the balance right. But and there is a degree of flexibility that's shown. But again, I'm maybe better bringing in Professor Steedman to see if she's got anything to add to that from a clinical perspective.
Yes, thanks very much. Yes, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So you're absolutely right again that at the inception of the programme, we had to ensure clearly, given that supplies were constrained for vaccines, that we were able to vaccinate the what we would like to be the entirety of the adult population at that time. And that meant clinically directing vaccines towards certain age groups where there were either greater benefits for that age group or lower risk from any potential adverse events from the vaccines. And I absolutely support that that was the right decision. I myself received AstraZeneca as part of the programme, turning up as an over 40, and that was absolutely the right thing to do. And I'll stress again that both types of vaccine are incredibly effective at preventing severe disease and death. That's what we have to remember. Having said that, there is now less of an issue with supply of mRNA vaccines. And in fact, because the booster program is going to use mRNA vaccines pretty much exclusively, then it is less of an issue. And boards do have a flexibility if someone turns up who might have previously been in the age group to receive an AstraZeneca vaccine, but the clinic has the mRNA vaccines and is only giving the mRNA vaccines, for example, the board has the flexibility to do that. The board has the flexibility to use those mRNA vaccines in people who would otherwise not be vaccinated. So we do want everyone to be vaccinated, absolutely. And as the Cabinet Secretary says, what we can't say is people can just come in and say, well, I want this vaccine or that vaccine or that vaccine, because in the end, we wouldn't recommend vaccines for groups, and the MRHA wouldn't authorise vaccines for groups if they weren't deemed to be safe and effective. But there is a degree of flexibility for operational reasons, which now means that it is more likely, I think, that people will receive mRNA vaccines if they are now coming for a primary vaccination course. And that may reassure some members of the public. In terms of the Moderna issue, we can follow that up separately with the Health Board, because as Moderna is also recommended, albeit in a half dose, as part of the booster programme, many clinics should be providing Moderna. So if that is what's needed, then we can hopefully follow that out outside. If a particular vaccine is not available, just to emphasise from the clinical point of view, it is possible to mix and match the vaccines and complete with another one. So it's not that that is going to be necessarily hugely problematic. It's just that, as I said before, sometimes that can increase the side effects for someone. So we always try to do the primary course with the same vaccine, and we'll try to organise that certainly for anyone who's having difficulty accessing it.
Okay,
it's more important
that people
get two doses of vaccine than not. Okay. Thank you.
Finally, I just wanted to touch on slightly different is the role of the JCVI. Now, on the whole, we have followed the JCVI pretty slavishly, as I think all the UK countries have, until we got to the 12 to 15-year-olds. And then there just seemed to be a bit more wriggle room. And as I understand it, the chief medical officers decided that bringing in the education side as well would make a different decision. So I just wonder, is that changing the relationship with the JCVI going forward? Or was that an exception? Or how are we looking at that?
I would certainly disagree with the characterisation of what happened. I would also, I probably wouldn't use the word slavishly. I think these are, JCVI are the experts in vaccination immunisation. I think it's important that every government listens carefully to what they have to say, but it doesn't mean we don't scrutinise where necessary and appropriately. And I think that would be the same for every government across the four nations. If you look at the JCVI advice on 12 to 15-year-olds, it is the JCVI who themselves recommended that health secretaries task their CMOs to look at the wider implications. So I wouldn't say that we moved away from the JCVI advice. It was the JCVI who advised us and said, look, we only have remit over health. And in terms of health benefits, actually, there is a marginal benefit, but not enough to suggest a universal offer. And therefore, we advise you, governments, to go task your CMOs to look at the broader implications around educational disruption, et cetera, et cetera. And then the CMOs didn't just decide to make that decision themselves. They spoke to the Royal College of Paediatricians. They spoke to others, of course, as you'd imagine, over the course of a number of days, and then gave us the advice that was to recommend a universal offer for 12 to 15 year olds. So I don't think it changes the dynamic. For me, although the Scottish Government doesn't have the same obligations upon it as the UK Government does in relation to JCVI advice, we still put absolute weight and stock in the advice of the JCVI. And I have to say, in terms of the JCVI, you know, they've sometimes given advice that has perhaps gone against the tide in terms of public opinion. You know, for example, the 8-week gap between dose one and dose two, which is different to a number of other countries, European countries, but actually they've proven to be right. You know, if we look at, I think, what happened in Israel, for example, when they lifted restrictions, a lot of the fact that they had to reimpose restrictions was put down initially, certainly, to the fact that the gap between dose one and dose two meant that they didn't have as much maximum protection as we would have here in the UK, because we followed the JCVI advice of that 8-week gap, which we think afforded a greater maximum protection. So I don't think it changes the dynamic of the relationship, and we put great stock in their advice.
I'm just going to bring in Alex Rowley again.
Just a quick one, really. Is the First Minister on Tuesday said the advisory subgroup on education and children's issues was due to meet and review whether the same restrictions that are in place now in schools should continue. Did that meeting take place? I might have missed the announcement.
Forgive me, I would have assumed it would have met, and forgive me, I haven't seen any particular outcome, or whether any outcome is different. I mean, the First Minister made her statement as he knows on Tuesday, so if there had been any significant announcements to make, I'm sure she would have made them, but I don't know if my officials wish to add anything more on that. But
said it may well be that they recommend keeping the current mitigations in place for longer than the risk period, but they were going to be considering them that afternoon. And it's just obviously for a lot of parents do write to us with regard to these issues.
Yeah, there's certainly no changes at the moment in terms of the mitigations that are in place for our children and young people. In fact, if anything, what we're trying to do is move forward activity around ventilation in schools at quite a pace, looking to do that at an even greater pace. But in terms of the mitigations, and look, I'm a parent to, as I mentioned, a 12-year-old who's just started high school as well. We know these mitigations, particularly around face coverings, are really difficult for young children. But at the moment, there's no change in terms of those mitigations. But if there is an update, I'm happy to provide it to the community.
So could we get an update as a committee, and also perhaps some kind of progress report on what progress has been made on the steps that are being taken to make schools safer for kids?
Yeah, I think particularly on the ventilation point, I'm sure we'd be happy to provide progress updates in that regard.
Thank you. If I could just ask one quick question, just going back to John Mason's point regarding the rollout of the boosters. Is it likely that we're all going to have boosters every 6 months? And is there any concern regarding vaccine supply?
So no concerns about supply at the moment. Supply issues are working well. And, you know, in my time as Health Secretary, the relationship with the other four nations have been really, really positive. I think it's worth putting on record my thanks to Nadeem Zahawi in particular, whose vaccines ministers I think rightly been elevated to cabinet level. He was very engaging, very accessible on issues around vaccines, and we exchanged messages quite often if there were any issues. So in terms of supply issues, and I've had good meetings, as you'd imagine, with manufacturers, there's no supply issues, including looking at the booster programme and so on and so forth. So that's all fine. In terms of JCVI advice, we continue to wait for JCVI advice in a number of areas, including boosters for the rest of the population. So we know that at the moment they've given us advice on what was traditionally kind of groups 1 to 9 in the priority groupings, and we're taking forward that advice. So we're still waiting for their advice. So I wouldn't want to preempt it, but certainly that issue of boosters for the rest of the population is something that's under active consideration.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Jim Fairley very briefly.
Very small one, I promise you. Can you just update us? We're still getting quite a number of requests from people who have had their first vaccine in other parts of the UK and getting their second one in Scotland, and it's just, are we any closer to getting a solution to that?
Yes, so I suppose two things I would say on the cross-border issue, and it does depend. It can be. I absolutely accept that it can be quite challenging, because it's different circumstances about, for example, if you had your first dose in Scotland, you had your second dose in England, or you had your first dose in England, second dose in Scotland, if you're out with the common travel area, etc., etc. So first thing to say is, when it comes to the certification scheme, your proof of vaccine, whether it's the English app or a paper copy, that will be accepted. So you're not going to be turned away from the football or a late night venue and so on and so forth. So absolutely. Where we have a bit of a challenge in terms of updating records is and what's kind of termed as orphan records sometimes, so those that have had a dose in England but they don't have an NHS number, effectively our equivalent of a CHI number, and that is an issue that they'd have to resolve with NHS England, and once they resolve that, then it can be resolved. I might bring Jonathan in to just give an update on where we are with the portal, which we're hoping to either launch today or very, very shortly, which will allow people to upload their record. And then the issue gets resolved in the other end. But Jonathan, do you want to just give an update on where we are with that? You're on mute. There you go.
Sorry. Just very briefly to say the portal is ready. We're preparing the necessary comms to go out, and that should all launch on Monday.
Okay. And that will hopefully help with that.
Thank you. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Cabinet Secretary. And I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and his supporting officials for their attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be on the 28th of October, when we will take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero, Energy and Transport for a ministerial statement on COVID-19 and subordinate legislation. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you.